And it was so irresponsibly inappropriate. Like, we were doing stuff that you could never do on TV. And I know Joel McHale. I've met him on a number of occasions. I've interacted with him. He's a super nice guy. But you know, when I have heard from people, either somebody like Joel or other people who work at the network or work on the show, he had an entirely, you know, E was a different network, and, yeah.
Well, I was going to ask you, could that show even exist nowadays? Yeah. We got John Henson in studio, by the way.
It was like the Wild West. Like, I don't think any show will ever experience that kind of creative freedom. I understand that, like, he had at times lawyers that would sit in on his taping.
Oh my
and like
God.
Stop the taping and go, you have to reword that joke. You have to say alleged.
Wow.
You have to, you know.
God.
But dude, we were off the chain completely, and never even gave a moment's thought to the audience or the ratings or whatever. It was just, let's just try to make each other laugh.
John Henson, can I ask you a question about Greg Kinnear? Was the first person in the chair, and I remember, you know, that was like a rocket ship to the moon, and that's what kind of got this show on the map. How did that feel having to replace?
I was a maniacal fan of Talk Soup before I got the show. I was a religious viewer. And I remember, before I even auditioned for it, I remember telling my girlfriend, I was in my 20s, I remember telling my girlfriend, you know, I feel like this is the kind of show I would be good at. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then when Greg announced that he was leaving, they started doing a big talent search to find a host to replace him. And they looked at over 3,000 people in five cities over 18 months. And I remember going on the audition, and I...
Now, you didn't have any kind of special in. You were just one of the...
I was just a comic in New York.
You were just one of the 3,000 people.
I was just a comic in New York. Every person I knew in the comedy business... was auditioning. Men, women, people that weren't in stand-up that were just like funny actors and hosts and stuff were auditioning. And I remember coming home and being like, dude, I think I nailed my audition. That went really well, you know? And like 8 or 9 months went by and I didn't hear
that
anything.
That long.
And then I got a call, hey, they want to see you again. I was like, what? I thought that was all over. And they were like, no, they said that they really liked you. And I remember coming home from the call back and being like, I think that went even better. You know what I mean? Like, I think I stuck my landing like a little Yugoslavian gymnast, you know?
Do you allow yourself to get,
it was.
It's hard not to envision yourself that, you know, getting.
Well, it's sort of like you got to kind of walk the line of, you know, you got to, I think you need to believe that you belong there. You know what I mean? You have to have the faith in yourself to be like,
what's that like?
You know what I mean? You got to be like, no, you guys should hire me without being cocky. You know what I mean? But it's the only time in my entire career. And I've been a comedian for over 30 years and I've been making television for 25. And you know, it's the only time in my career that I've ever been told the exact thing I did that got me the job. My executive producer, Alex Duda, who went on to win numerous Emmys, you know, producing shows for Tyra Banks and Steve Harvey, she said, I remember it. I was doing the audition. They would give you a script and then they would tell you to, you know, improvise, feel like you can improvise. And I was reading a tease to Break in their sample script, and it was like, coming up on Jerry Springer, my grandma's a thief, and I just threw in the line, I go, not my grandma personally, my grandma's on the grift, which is a totally different form of short con altogether. And she was, and Alex was like, when I heard the words grift, short con used so casually by like this tiny little pencil neck white guy, I was like, okay, I'm pulling this tape. So that was fun to know sort of what I did that stuck out.
It's Josh Spiegel. Remember, there are lots of ways to listen to 98 Rock every day. 97.9 FM, streaming live on 98online.com. The 98 Rock smartphone app on iPhone and Android and on your Amazon Alexa and Google Home. Make sure to follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/98online.